Welcome back. This is Meet the Press. Our guest is the Attorney General Robert McClelland, and welcome now the panel, Lauren Wilson from The Australian, Dylan Welch from The Age. Good morning to both of you.
Morning.
Morning.
Now, US intelligence agencies remain on high alert at this hour over the potential Al-Qaeda anniversary attack everyone's been talking about. President Obama says, though, terrorism will never win.
There should be no doubt. Today, America is stronger, and Al-Qaeda is on the path to defeat.
10 years on from 9/11, what's your understanding of the risk profile of aspiring attackers? Is Australia more at risk of a 9/11-style attack where you see insurgents flying in from overseas in the days or months before an attack, or is it the threat of homegrown terrorism?
You can't discount either possibility, but, I mean, if you look at the history, there's been 4 terrorist attacks foiled in Australia, 38 people charged, some cases before the courts, but 21 of those, I think it is, were born in Australia. So if you're looking at the history, the major threat in Australia has been from the so-called homegrown potential terrorist.
US authorities are responding to a credible and specific terror threat in Washington and New York at the moment. Do you have any specific intelligence to suggest that Australia is at a higher state of risk on this anniversary?
No, our alert level remains at medium, which means that a terrorist attack certainly is feasible. But if we had evidence of a specific attack, we would then raise the alert level to high. And that hasn't occurred since the September 11 attacks. But certainly a terrorist attack is feasible in Australia, but there's no specific evidence of an intended one at the current time.
Has there been any intelligence that has perhaps raised your eyebrows recently?
I'm responsible for signing the warrant process, and every time I sign these warrants, the material in them does raise my concern. It's obviously material that isn't made public. I should stress, however, that the scope and the focus of the investigation is a very, very narrow group of people, but nonetheless, they are a group that would be intent on harming their fellow citizens.
In 2008, the then Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, delivered a national security statement, our first. He promised that the government would deliver subsequent iterations of that document every 12 months. Since then, almost 3 years on, and we've heard nothing. Why is that?
No, there will be a national security statement updating that. The statement was important. We've had the counter-terrorism white paper that has been issued as part of that process, but certainly we will be providing a national security statement, and some work is being done on that, as well as work generally and constantly drawing together and auditing the interaction between the agencies.
In the same period, 2008 to now, the UK has published 2 national security strategies, white papers in effect, much more formal than a statement. Australia, 10 years on from 9/11, still does not have an overarching formal document. The academic world, senior national security bureaucrats, they all know it's needed. Seems that the only people uninterested in national security strategy is the political class. Why is that?
We've looked at overseas experience. We've looked specifically at the British as to whether we would benefit from a national security strategy or whether that would be too restrictive. We have taken the approach of looking at the broader national security statements. It's not our current intention to go for a national security strategy. The real risk is you've got national security statements, you've got counter-terrorism plans, and then you're looking at a national security strategy. What document prevails can create its own confusion. So for that reason, we've decided not to create a third document, if you like.
We continue to hear about Afghanistan and Pakistan and Somalia and Yemen as key terror hotspots, but isn't it the case that the greatest threat to Australia remains Indonesia?
Having said that, Indonesia has done some terrific work, and we work with them as partners. They've apprehended probably more terrorists than any other country in the world. But having said that, there is no doubt that we need to work with Indonesia to monitor those who are active in Indonesia and the contacts they have in Australia. There is no question that is required and is done. We have very close relations both with federal police and also our security agencies.
Have we begun to underestimate that threat, though?
I don't think so. There's a lot of resources going into it, we constantly evaluate that.
Can I take you to another matter? Craig Thompson. George Brandis has for the second time asked for the police to investigate not only Thompson but the Health Services Union. He's completely within his rights to make those requests of police, is he not?
Any citizen can refer any alleged breach of the law to the police. Indeed, I've done it on several occasions as Attorney General. In truth, my role as an officer of the Commonwealth doesn't give me any greater status to do that, so that can be done. I don't think the police regard it as helpful, however, when politicians comment on the merits of the matters. I think once it's referred, I think the police have to judge the
merits. All that nonsense about separation of powers, there being some terrible breach about him raising these matters that we've heard previously, that's a lot of politicking, isn't it?
Well, again, it's I think politicians should bear in mind they're not prosecutors and they should avoid crossing that line, and indeed I don't think the police appreciate when politicians seek to try and encourage or induce them to take a particular course of action. It ultimately could potentially affect the public's confidence in the independent role of the prosecutors and the police. It's a matter of propriety, and that's as high as I'll put it.
Now, same-sex marriage, if I can get you on another issue, we've got the ALP conference coming up later this year, so there's going to be a big issue there. Your position on this in the past has been very much not one for reform. What position will you take in this?
Well, the Marriage Act's within my portfolio. Look, obviously I'll listen to the debate on it, but can I say that as part of the reforms that we introduced, the 84 amendments or the amendments to 84 pieces of legislation, I was involved in intricate discussions with all sides of the equation. I, by and large, drew parties together, and I drew them together on the basis that was the end of the line, and the government supported marriage, the definition as being between a man and a woman, and I have to be true to myself and the negotiations I had.
So it would be a betrayal to the system, in your view, if Labor was now to try and push through a marriage amendment to the Marriage Act?
At a personal level, when I was in the discussions and I brought together, I think, a broad consensus of the community to support those amendments, I did so on the basis that my stated intention, the government didn't intend to amend the Marriage Act. So I have to acknowledge those negotiations I had, and I have to be true to the position I took in those negotiations.
Quick question. Will Kevin Rudd ever again be Prime Minister of Australia?
Well, in terms of the Labor Party, Julia Gillard is the leader of the party, and she will remain as so. There's no question about that. I think anything else is media gossip, but she is clearly the very strongly supported Prime Minister.
Certainly Mr Rudd seems to think he has a chance, doesn't he?
I haven't spoken to Kevin on that. Kevin can have his view, but from the party's point of view, we're firmly behind Julia Gillard.
OK, thank you for being with us. The Attorney-General, Robert McClelland. Thank you. Now, coming up, an Australian diplomat with a unique story of September 11, 2001. And with her news poll numbers as deeply underwater as the Mariana Trench, the Australian's Peter Nicholson saw bad omens for the Prime Minister at the Pacific Islands Forum.